So let's consider this, these names, Billy the Kid, the Joker, Annie Hall, Antoine Doinel, Holly-Golightly, Sugar Cane, Anton Chigurh, the Joker, Emily Vijay Chauhan, Jack Sparrow, Professor Higgins, Raju the Guide, Scarlett O'Hara, Tyler Durden. What's common among all these people or all these names? Well, I think you guessed that. These are great cinematic characters. Okay, and why do we still refer to them? I mean, Scarlett O'Hara from Gone with the Wind, Tyler Durden from Fight Club, Raju the Guide from Vijay Anand's Guide, based on R.K. Narayan's famous novel. You have Holly-Golightly from Breakfast at Tiffany's and Sugar Cane from Some Like It Hot. Marilyn Monroe playing Sugar Cane, the quintessential dumb blonde that was her image. Jack Sparrow from Pirates of the Caribbean, Professor Higgins, and of course Eliza Doolittle from My Fair Lady. Now, why are we interested in these names? Antoine Doinel, we have already talked about. 400 Blows, that is a Truffaut's film. We have also talked about Emily. And why are we interested in all these names? These are great characters, okay? And great characters always remain with us. You think of a movie, you remember a movie for a variety of reasons. If there is a strong characterization, the film always remains with you. So what makes a character interesting? Now, all these characters, they are not necessarily morally good characters. So we are not talking about good versus evil. I mean, when you think of a character like Anton Chigurh from No Country for Old Men, so he, you know, he is a walking devil, Satan himself. We are not interested in characters who are only morally good or morally upright characters. Atticus Finch, for example, he's the essential, quintessential good guy that I'm talking about, To Kill a Mockingbird. So I'm talking about characters who are interesting, who have stayed in our collective consciousness over a period of several decades. And so we have been talking about cinema and the history of cinema. So what we are interested in are what makes a character interesting. See, we are halfway through the course, and it is essential to understand. We have been talking about various movements. We have also talked about cinematic theory, cinematic concepts. We have also talked about the studio years. So and film genres, film theory. So several things have been discussed in this course. We have also talked about various dimensions of plot. So what, now there cannot be any plot without a character, that goes without saying. So cinema largely depends on, it's important that we know the people behind the camera, but we should also spare some thought for people who are in front of the camera. I mean, throughout this course, I have been largely talking about people behind the camera. So the editors, the director, the filmmakers, the studios, the producers. This session is specifically devoted to the great characters and the films that have immortalized these great characters. Now, the idea of discussing characters is nothing new. We know that in poetics, Aristotle, that was in 4th century BC, clearly articulated the requisites of a hero. He talked about the ideal tragic hero and paved the way for character analysis. An ideal tragic hero, according to the Greek philosopher, embodies complexities. Although he must be an essentially good man with a fatal flaw. For Aristotle, this term is hamartia. in the classical Greek theater, a character was defined and explained by the mask he wore. So they would essentially wear a mask, perhaps, you know, a sad look, a sad mask, smiling mask, so to show perhaps the happy feelings. I mean, Greek theater was an enormous space, and people who sat at the back, okay, at far behind, they wouldn't be able to see the characters or the actors enacting a particular character and their emotions. So it was essential that these spectators should identify characters by the mask they wore. Now, this led to certain kind of stereotyping, and stereotyping remained so for let's say even till the beginning of the 20th century in theater and literature, and also we are talking about cinema. So for a long time in cinema too, we had this idea of stereotyping. But here we are interested in such characters which are essentially multidimensional, dynamic characters. So characters that are dynamic are interesting. So that's the concept that we are going to discuss today. When flat characters and static characters can also be interesting, but then it takes a particular kind of a film to make such characters interesting. By and large, we are interested, or we are concerned with those characters that are well-rounded, well-sketched, well-developed, and have an edge to them. Theoretically, E.M. Forster in Aspects of the Novel discriminates between flat and round characters. According to Forster, a flat character is a type, a stock, or two-dimensional. So Forster spelling F-O-R-S-T-E-R, you can look E.M. Forster and his Aspects of the Novel to know more about this. According to Forster, a flat character is a type. Okay, so we have been talking about stereotyped characters, which are two-dimensional, which do not have an edge to them or any further personality to them. Good characters are essentially good, bad characters are essentially bad. You can always refer to, for example, most of the TV series characters that we watch. So these are essentially flat characters. So you have the scheming daughter-in-law or the long-suffering daughter-in-law, and a very unidimensional kind of the patriarch, the head of the family, the husband, the father-in-law. Generally, they don't have, in many of the series that we are watching nowadays, so they don't have much to do. So I am basically talking about the very commercial mainstream kind of TV series that are on air, especially in our country. So this is these characters too serve a kind of purpose, but we are not talking about. What we are saying is that flat character essentially remains uninteresting. They do not have much of detailing, okay, or individualizing. So the writer or the filmmaker is not particularly interested in giving any details to these characters. Flat characters can also be described in a single phrase or sentence. For example, we say a good character, a scheming character, a villainous character, or a suffering character, etc. So these characters can be described in a single phrase or sentence. On the other hand, as Forster tells us, a round character is complex in his motivation or treatment. He is represented with subtle peculiarities, and has such a character is difficult to describe with any adequacy like any person in real life. A well-rounded character is always capable of surprising us. That means that there are hidden facets to this character. From here we move on to, from Forster, I'll take you a little backward in time. That is Henry James and his Art of Fiction, which was published way back in 1884. Now, Henry James tells us about telling characters where the author, the writer, intervenes authoritatively in order to describe and to evaluate the motives and dispositional qualities of the character. For example, Jane Austen does it very frequently for her characters. If you read her novel Pride and Prejudice, you will understand that she tells us what to make out of her characters. Showing characters, which is also called dramatic method, and this is Henry James's second category of characters, and he tells us that here readers are expected to infer what motives and dispositions lie behind what the characters say or do. Now, if you apply this idea to the character that we are doing here, so in a character such as Holygolightly or in a character such as Anton Chigurh, you as a film watcher, you are expected to infer what drives these characters around. Okay, so it is important that we understand these things, these distinctions. Many a time we are just told, a lot of things are told to us about a character. For example, if you think of Suraj Varjatya's films, characters in his films. Now, we are often told a lot about characters before they arrive on the scene. You know, in Maine Pyar Kiya aur Hum Saath Saath Hain, or even Hum Aapke Hain Kaun. So, much is said, you know, he is, for example, we are told that he's a very innocent boy, or the girl, she is, you know, very chaste and absolutely like, a docile, a submissive kind of a girl, very obedient. So these things are told to us. Okay, they are not just shown to us. We are not supposed to infer, because these are a different set of movies catering to a particular set of audiences, and those audiences constantly need to be told what is happening. When we talk about literature or cinema or any art of superior intellect, then we have to understand that there the artist is not going to go at length or be at pains to explain every detail, every motivation and every characteristic of the plot or the character. He just shows them to you, and it's left to you to infer. I would also like to refer to director Frank Capra, whose works we have been referring to constantly here. He talks about how characters serve to involve an audience. For Capra, you have to give them something to worry about, some person to worry about and care about, and you have got them involved. See, audiences are involved when you give them someone to care about or someone to get involved with. And let's think of a movie such as It's a Wonderful Life, directed by Capra. Okay, and there James Stewart's character. Now, he is a small town businessman. His business is about to finish. He blames the world around him, and he also contemplates committing suicide. But then there is a guardian angel who comes along, and he tells him all the good things that the character has done throughout his life in that small town and how many lives he has touched. Now, through that, now it's a very telling kind of a character. You know, you're not being shown, you're told constantly, but then that's Frank Capra, that is very sentimental and quite unsubtle. So, but the idea is that you have to care about a character, and that we do about James Stewart character. Now, consider another James Stewart character from Hitchcock's Vertigo. We have been discussing Vertigo also throughout this course. Now, what happens in Vertigo? He is a very complex character. He is not easy to understand. Hitchcock shows us the character. He doesn't tell you much about the character, except that how he developed his fear of heights, how his vertigo. That's all. Apart from that, much is left to the audience to decide. In Psycho, however, the motivation and the psychological complexities of the character, they are all revealed at the end of the film, when there is an elaborate description or explanation of the character's misdeeds, Norman Bates, and why a character like him becomes a killer. serial killer. So his psychoses are explained at length in the court of law. So that was something that critics really found quite disturbing, because had he left certain things unsaid, then it is believed that Hitchcock's Psycho would have been a greater film. So again, we are talking about showing character and telling character. Now, a thing that usually marks a character is his or her accent, dialect, vocabulary and grammar. These things tell us about the character's background, including socioeconomic level, education and mental processes. So, a character in a cop drama or a gangster saga will speak very differently from the protagonist, for example, in a martial arts film or a samurai film or in a comedy. Appearances also make a lot of difference. Here I am going to show you a wonderful clipping from Coen Brothers' Fargo, starring Frances McDormand. Watch this particular sequence and understand how her accent, dialect and her appearance shape the kind of character she is. Characters can also be understood through action. So, action could be external or internal. So, for example, I can give you names such as Schwarzenegger's Commander or even Terminator. It's Schwarzenegger and he does what comes naturally to the character. It's Sylvester Stallone, and when we watch him in Rocky or Rambo, then they do what comes very naturally to them. Okay, these are action heroes. John McClane in Die Hard, he does what is expected of him. Okay, is in Bruce Willis's a Die Hard character, John McClane character. Of course, we also get a tinge of humor that was also possible. That was also present in Terminator. So, those things give an added dimension to the character, but by and large we know what to expect from them, and these characters define themselves through their external actions. Now, internal actions, let's think again, let's go back again to Vertigo and James Stewart character and Anthony Perkins's character in Psycho. Now, these characters have certain secret desires, aspirations, motivated by some deep psychological motives, okay, or actions. So, those things define these characters, and many a time they are informed by visual and oral metaphors. When we look at the shot of Anthony Perkins standing in his motel with a stuffed bird on the wall, then we have to understand that what the director is trying to tell us something about the character. Now, internal action, again, as I have been telling you about, a character, how he is motivated, how she is motivated, is he is all driven by psychological complexities. We have been talking about Scorsese's characters, for example, Travis Bickle, and the character who talks to himself and he says, "You talking to me?" That is De Niro in Taxi Driver. So, watch that particular scene, "You talking to me?" and action, and observe how action takes place internally. He's externally it does happen, but much of the action takes place internally. Therefore, the constant use of voice over in Taxi Driver and also in Mean Streets. So, we have also done clippings from Mean Streets and Harvey Keitel's character, who is in a state of dilemma between his loyalty towards his friends and his belief in his Catholic faith. So, these characters are psychologically complex, multi-layered and multi-dimensional, and they are all driven through internal action. Internal action of characters is projected through secrets, aspirations, memories, dreams and fantasies. We have to also assume that real characters are more than mere instruments of the plot, that they do what they do for a purpose out of motives that are consistent with their overall personality. So when these characters are shown to us, we call them more real. Otherwise, as soon as a character starts acting out of character, we call them unreal characters. Names also define a character. Observe, for instance, Val Kilmer's character in Saint and the kinds of personalities he assumes, the identities he assumes. So names can be evocative, symbolic. They can also be ironic at times. For example, think of Daniel Day-Lewis's character in The Last of the Mohicans. He is Hawkeye. Why do you think he's called Hawkeye? An interesting device that many filmmakers adapt or adopt for making characters more interesting is making us read these characters through multiple perspectives. So one such device is followed in Citizen Kane, where the dying hero says Rosebud, and then a journalist is on the trail. Why did this rich, influential and powerful man had only one word on his lips before dying? That is Rosebud, and that one word gives us clues to the character. Velvet Goldmine is another interesting film, a more recent film. You should watch this film in order to understand how the director has followed the multiple perspective device in order to portray a character. Static characters where nothing much happens, where they are a character who drinks is always shown as a compulsive drunkard. For example, the movie directed by Robert Redford, River, runs through it. So you have the character of Paul, who is impetuous. He gets involved in card games, wants nothing more than to stay in Montana and work for a newspaper. Dynamic characters. So on the other hand, we have been talking about a static character. So dynamic characters is the opposite. And these characters undergo personality change. Now think, for example, Michael Corleone, as played by Al Pacino in The Godfather. Now he becomes wiser, mature, perhaps more sinister, perhaps more responsible, more self-confident by the end of the movie. Julia Roberts' character too, at the end of Erin Brockovich, she becomes a person who is transformed. She starts off as a nervous, very shaky kind of a character. By the end of it, when she has exposed a major corruption in her small town, she is much more self-confident and self-reliant. Okay. Sleeping with the Enemy, again starring Julia Roberts, is another example of a dynamic character. Dynamic characters are essential for serious drama. Comedy may not require too much of dynamism or change. Think Charlie Chaplin's constant persona, frequent persona of the tramp. Raj Kapoor, the tramp, always the quintessential innocent particularly caught among the corrupt city forces in both these cases. So while dynamic characters are essential for serious drama, comic characters do not require too much of dynamism. Otherwise, the element of surprise wouldn't be too helpful to create the comic effect. So what we have been learning, flat characters, they are two-dimensional, predictable, they lack complexity and psychological depth. However, their repetitive behavior makes for comedy. So for comic characters, we need flat characters, who generally represent character types, Mr. Bean kind of characters. So, and a round character is a completely opposite. Multidimensional, unpredictable, and they are saturated or imbued with psychological depth. Think of Marlon Brando in On the Waterfront and James Dean in Rebel Without a Cause, and observe how these characters evolve, change, and show edges to their character through the course of the film. Again, also, for example, think of Saturday Night Fever and Raging Bull. These films we have been discussing, and if you watch these films, you will understand how these characters evolve and change. So these are dynamic characters. However, we have a very popular franchise, Ocean's 11, 12, 13, and the franchise. The characters here do not evolve, they are not dynamic, but then that is essential to retain the flavor of the franchise. So we have to make these distinctions. The characters don't change. Why is it that they don't change? Okay, it's not because the actors are not good enough, or the screenwriter is not good enough, or the director doesn't have too many ideas. But in a franchise, it is always useful to have a hint of flatness so that the audiences get what they expect. That's the beauty of a franchise. Stereotypical characters are other set of characters. We have the courtesan with a heart of gold, as we have all often seen in our discussions of films such as Devdas, Mukaddar Ka Sikandar, Umrao Jaan, golden-hearted prostitute or courtesan. We also have the stereotype of alcoholic lover, for example, Devdas and Mukaddar Ka Sikandar, and many more such films. So these are stereotypical characters. We also have another interesting category of characters, that are enigmatic characters. Now, think of Juliette Binoche's character in Chocolat. She is mysterious, not much is known about her past, and that's what constitutes the beauty of her character, the interest in her character. Another similar character is Ben Whishaw's character in Perfume, the story of a murderer. We know something about his background, but he still remains an extremely enigmatic character. He doesn't speak too much, and we are forever left to search for his motives. Here, watch a clipping from Usual Suspects, the Kaiser Soze clipping, and consider how Verbal Clint emerges as a very enigmatic character, although he is not supposed to be. There's also, when we talk about characters, we also refer to dramatic foils. Now, what are foils? F-O-I-L-S, foils. These are contrasting characters. For example, in Harold and Maude, if you watch this particular film, Harold and Maude, you will understand that this is a love story between an 80-year-old woman and a 20-year-old boy. So these are contrasting characters with different attitude towards life. Again, foils are also Jay and Veeru's characters in Sholay. These are contrasting characters. They have very little in common. However, they complement each other beautifully. Foil characters can be good versus evil, and strong versus silent, loud versus flamboyant. And this also adds an added, you know, a kind of a dimension to the character, character sketch of the film. It is also very common in the cop buddy films, Miami Vice and 48 Hours, and also Lethal Weapon. So, contrasting sense of attributes in two characters. So, they, in other words, they complement each other. Here is a clipping from The Dark Knight. So what we have observed here is that the Joker literally telling the Dark Knight, Batman, the hero, that the two of them are sort of complementary to each other. One cannot exist without the other. So, in other words, they act as foils to each other. Foils again are very common in buddy films. We have already talked about the cop drama in buddy films also. For example, Rain Man, Tom Cruise and Dustin Hoffman. And in Midnight Run, watch Robert De Niro and Charles Grodin. So these two actors playing perfect foil to each other. One of the most effective techniques of characterization thus is the foil. It contrasts characters and we are fascinated, drawn to them because of the contrast in their attitude, behavior, opinions, lifestyle, physical appearance and so on. So Lauren and Hardy, okay, and that brings an element of interest to the characters. We can also think of, Fenster and Verbal Clint in The Usual Suspects and how different they are from each other, as well as from Dean Keaton, who is as suave and sophisticated as they come. Now, filmmakers also often resort to using caricatures and leitmotifs to develop a character. A character such as the lead character in Sunset Boulevard, which we have been talking about quite frequently in this course. So here we have this fading actress who refuses to believe that her time's up, and she still feels that there is a legion of fans waiting outside her mansion. So she is deliberately given, Billy Wilder and his screenwriters deliberately give Gloria Swanson exaggerated features and exaggerated lines, over the top lines, in order to make her look like a caricature of her former self. Caricatures can be comic as well as tragic. Leitmotif, however, refers to repetition of a single action, gesture, phrase, idea by a character. In Sholay, you remember Amitabh Bachchan's Jai often uses a coin to decide whether they should go ahead with a job or not. So that coin becomes a sort of leitmotif to that character. And at the end, we know how important that role that coin plays in their lives. The leitmotif is also a kind of a trademark, and you can also have a piece of music that is used repeatedly to define a character. For example, James Bond, the flute in Kill Bill Part 2, Mission Impossible theme, the Godfather theme. So all these are pieces of music that act as leitmotif. A catchphrase such as "I'll be back," that is Schwarzenegger telling you in Terminator, that also becomes a character's leitmotif. And you know how successfully that line has been played even in subsequent films. Filmmakers also use allegorical characters. So we have allegorical good and bad characters taken from our own epics. And in America during the 50s, there was a film called High Noon, which alludes to the McCarthy period in the persona of the sheriff as played by Gary Cooper. We have other set of characters which are more difficult to understand, more abstract in construction, but is still interesting if you look at them that way. So Ingmar Bergman's films are known for moral dialectics and philosophical characters. If you want to know more about those characters, you must watch Persona, Seventh Seal and also Wild Strawberries. So Ingmar Bergman's characters and films are known for their philosophical inclinations. The Seventh Seal, for example, one of the most important films of Bergman, is a cinematic model of existentialism, a character's apocalyptic search for meaning. He is played by a knight who is in search of meaning of life. So this tale is about a hero, that is the knight, who challenges death. And death is an allegory, it takes an allegorical interpretation. And there is a game of chess between the knight and death. So although this film is about understanding people and themselves in terms of philosophical questions, Bergman also wants the audience to experience the film with the issue of the problems of evil, philosophy of religion. A very existentialist movie, and it should be watched through that perspective. So several films, several characters, and eventually when you read a film or you want to understand a film, or even if you want to write a screenplay, think along these lines. So thank you very much. We'll meet for our next class.